a fair good standard of living from football. Certainly there's a lot of worries and a lot of hard times in it, but I think the most any manager gets from football is seeing everyday boys join a club as youngsters and growing into men and giving themselves better social standing than they could ever have dreamed of from a game of football.
When you're looking for players, you're looking for ability, but you're looking for courage as well. Ability without courage is no good. The two of them combined something. I don't mean courage where you want to fight somebody if they kick you or something. That's rubbish. That's not courage at all. That's stupidity. I mean courage to control the ball in close situations, not to be afraid of the opposition.
When the war came to an end, I, like many others, had to face some facts, some hard facts. I was about 36 years of age. My days as a player were numbered. I couldn't live in memories. I had to think of my loaves and fishes. Yet I couldn't think of leaving this wonderful game of football. So I decided to try my hand as a manager.
From the vantage point of the present, the achievements of Matt Busby, Bill Shankly and Jock Stein are seen to be linked by far more than their shared origins in what was the West of Scotland coalfield. But the sense of a natural triumvirate that emerges from the historical record, and which was certainly strengthened for me by long friendships with all of them, obviously didn't suggest itself in their early years in football. At the end of the Second World War, Bill Shankly was realizing that his days as a player at Preston were coming to an end. Jock Stein, 9 years younger than Shankly, had yet to progress beyond part-time professionalism with Albion Rovers and was working underground in the kind of Lanarkshire pit Matt Busby had left as a teenager. Naturally enough, it was Busby, the oldest of the three, who was leading the way into management with his appointment at Manchester United. The second film of this trilogy traces Busby's extraordinary pioneering example and how the careers of Shankly and Stein accelerated in a way that would eventually force the football world to regard the ex-miners as a unique collective phenomenon.
All I had, apart from playing experience, with certain ideas as to what the manager should do, faith in those ideas, and faith in the future of the club. But the success of a club does not depend on one man. It depends on cooperation. Cooperation between the board of directors, who make the final decisions on policy. The staff, the players, and the supporters. The loyalty of all these is essential.
When Matt Busby took over Manchester United, there were problems at Old Trafford that predated war damage. For decades, United had been very much Manchester's second football club, thoroughly overshadowed by Busby's former employers, Manchester City. Old Trafford, as we see it today, was built on foundations laid by Busby's progressive vision and strength of purpose. His impact on the place was that of a quiet revolutionary. Being a novice in management didn't prevent him from insisting on absolute control over all football matters at the club. He made all appointments to his staff, crucially those of Jimmy Murphy as his assistant and Bert Wally as backup for Murphy, and he gave a priority to the development of young players within the club that was unprecedented in the British game.
How do you recall him in those days? You know, was he a strict father?
Yeah, he was. It was to me anyway. He was quite strict as I got into my teenage, you know. Although, really, it was my mother that brought Sandy and I up, really, because Matt was away all during the war.
Yes.
So, but when he could always, you didn't have to say, you just got the look.
Oh, I see. That applied not only to players, it applied to the children too. A look was enough. Was it?
Yeah. He used to come home, say, on a Friday. He'd pick the team. And he'd be upset because he'd left somebody out and so forth. And he used to always discuss it with my mum. You know, and she used to say, well, you'll always do the right thing, Matt.
Finalists take the field at Wembley. Manchester United in dark shirts, Blackpool in white. It's the North's big day. Sunshine.
Commitment to youth was already basic to Busby's approach, but veterans still predominated in 1948 when he achieved his first landmark success with United by winning the FA Cup. They hadn't been in the final since 1909.
Whistles the ball away downfield where Carey meets it, Nicholas Shaw puts it to Delaney. Delaney now, with all the United forwards up there, puts that ball through, and he's let it go! And it's a goal! A beautiful goal by Rowling! He would let it go! Rowling put it past the centre-half, and just calmly beats the goalkeeper, puts it in the net, all in one.
My whole life had been instinctively knowing that we had to get through the war. It was a question of surviving, as opposed to achieving. And then suddenly Busby and that team of 1948 put before youngsters of my generation and my age the clear knowledge that there is something to, that there is more to life than just surviving. There's something that can be achieved.
John Stalker, former Deputy Chief Constable of Manchester, remembers what that day in 48 meant to his native city.
I recall the day very clearly because everyone had the windows open, and if you didn't have a radio or you for some reason couldn't stay in the house, you could hear the football match sort of.
You listened to somebody else's.
Because this was very close.
It was a communal radio.
And Manchester got a free kick right up in the goal. I've got the heads to goal.
The King hands the silver trophy to skipper Johnny Carey. Their 4-2 victory, snatched in the last few minutes, gives Manchester United the reward they richly deserve.
It was Busby who did it. We didn't realise it as youngsters, but of course, because he was the manager, he wasn't on the pitch. But we knew that somebody somewhere had guided a team which didn't have any great history of success to Wembley and to win.
I've had the utmost support from my directors, my colleague on the staff and the players. I've had the priceless blessing of a wonderful mother. I've had a wonderful wife and an Andra from happy home.
Jean Busby, like her husband, was brought up in a mining family in the Bells Hill area of Lanarkshire. In her case, it was a Protestant family, but the strength of feeling that brought the two of them together and turned Jean into a Catholic made them an extremely close, mutually dependent couple throughout their lives. She was a supportive partner in everything he did, especially in furthering his concept of the football club as extended family.
And your mother, I believe, used to take your wives out when the team were away.
She took them out. They used to meet at my mum's house. Yeah. They used to go out for dinner.
I think it was through her own experience. But, in the old days, players' wives were never invited to a football match. Never looked after, really.
It is interesting that the strong, long-lasting marriages that plainly helped these three men to cope with the hazardous variables of their lives in football were all made with women from their own part of the country. Jean Stein met her future husband in a chip shop near their Lanarkshire homes, and although Corporal Shankly of the RAF married Agnes, or Ness, while she was serving in the women's branch of that service, it was an Ayrshire-Glasgow union.
The same feelings as I carried along as a player. I carried along as I was going to be a manager of a football club.
Yeah, a lot of people have seen in the great Scottish football stars an element of arrogance, you know, that here's Tayers Wise like us. Do you think you've got that?
I don't think it's arrogance. I think it's confidence and pride. I think arrogance is it's not a good word, really. I mean, I think it's arrogance, it could have the same kind of meaning as hypocrisy. I mean, I think arrogance is a very bad word. I think it should be stricken from the dictionary.
In 1949, a year after Manchester United's FA Cup win indicated that Busby was likely to prove an exceptional manager, Shankly was taking his first management job in the more humble setting of Carlisle.
And when he came here, he started addressing the fans directly,
yeah,
didn't he?
This is your manager speaking, like, it was through the tannoy. But people loved it. People would come down early to, you know, they didn't want to arrive at the kick-off, they wanted to listen to Bill. Yeah. And he used to tell them the team news and what he expected, and, you know, a few locals in, give him a cheer, and this was Bill. I mean, and he had this sort of rapport with the public. They loved it. People say it was a breath of fresh air. I thought it was a sort of a twister, you know, this film, The Twister. I mean, that was the sort of impact he had, yeah. You know, Bill.
Ivor Broaddus had been player-manager of Carlisle before Shankly arrived, but in his own and the club's financial interests, Broaddus had moved to Sunderland, who were eager to sign a man whose brilliance as an inside forward made him a worthy England partner for Tom Finney. Although London-born, he still lives in Carlisle.
I met Bill the first day he was here, I think, and he was staying at a hotel, and I said to him, Bill, I said, it must be terrible living out of a suitcase. I said, you must come up and have a meal with my wife and I. And he said, I'll come tomorrow night. You see, but it didn't matter that tomorrow night was a Tuesday and I was playing at home.
At Sunderland?
At Sunderland, but that didn't matter.
He went along anyway.
Bill went along and talked football to Joan, and I arrived back.
What time did you get home?
Well, I got home around about 10-ish, and we talked till maybe 1:30 in the morning, and then I walked down from the bungalow I had on Brough Road with Bill as far as Carr's Biscuit Works, and he talked most of the way, Bill. I mean, he was that type of character.
As you came towards the end of your playing career, did you have any doubt in your mind that you wanted to stay in the game on the management side?
Oh, that was all uppermost in my mind from the day I was born, to play football and to stay in it. I mean, this is the only thing I knew.